I am Gaitonde, he is Bhandarkar, and we will be discussing with you thermodynamics in mechanical engineering for the next week or so. And again, we will continue to meet electronically till May, June, when we will conduct a 2-week or a 10 working day session. What you see here is a tentative timetable, because I and we don't really know what we are in for during these 5 days. Our main aim is to make that 2-week program or that 10-day program a proper success, right? We have taught thermodynamics a large number of times. I have been a faculty member here for over 30 years, and maybe more than 15 times I have taught the undergraduate course in thermodynamics. The course itself has gone through a number of modifications, but the basic structure has more or less remained the same. I first taught it in 1982, and the latest implementation was last semester. And most of you have taught thermodynamics at least a few times. I noticed someone has 22 or 25 years experience. I won't be surprised that he or she has taught thermodynamics about a dozen times. Okay. So generally, we know what thermodynamics is about. So one thing we are not going to do is, this is not a formal lecture course in thermodynamics. Okay. Having said that, this is, remember this, TTT, what is meant by that? Time temperature transformation curve, okay? But as teachers, I think I should go back. When I was an undergraduate, there was no QIP program. QIP program, I think, started in 1971 or so. But there were a few college teachers from other colleges. They were here, and they were known as TTTs. The TTT program was a predecessor or precursor of the QIP program. That TTT program was known as, it stood for Technical Teacher Training Program. And I think at that time, a few institutes were set up. Maybe they are still there. They are known as TTTIs, Technical Teacher Training Institute, I suppose. I don't know whether they still exist or not. One was somewhere in Bhopal, one was in Madras, one in Chandigarh, okay. But being in Mumbai, I found that Bhopal and Madras were being talked about at that time. Okay. Today also we have a TTT program. You can call Train the Teacher, and there is also a formal Talk to the Teacher program. Okay. So, we are going to do discussion on thermodynamics, which is another T. So maybe train teachers in thermodynamics, or teach teachers how to manage thermodynamics. You can pick it like that. Okay. What you see here is the topic list of thermodynamics. But I would like to spend up to 11, and then after 11 up to the lunch time, on a preliminary discussion about what we are going to do. In your handout, you will find a list of topics, a sort of a structure of the way we have been teaching, or a reasonably neat course in undergraduate mechanical engineering thermodynamics is taught. When Professor Fatak requested me to start off or kick off the first non-CS course under this Eklavya scheme, or whatever scheme that is, there is an IST workshop, then there is a national mission on education of teachers through in ICTs, okay? Let us call this simply by the word Ekalavya, and that is why I have used the symbol Ekalavya on your exercise sheets and others. He said there is a course called Introduction to Mechanical Engineering in many, many colleges, or Basic Mechanical Engineering in many, many colleges. Why don't you teach that? And he said, why me? He said, no, a reasonable part of that is thermodynamics. You have been a good teacher of thermodynamics, so why don't you do it? And we undertook a survey and we found that there is a difference in the way thermodynamics is treated as a basic undergraduate course in mechanical engineering. IIT is treated in a different ways. Many colleges treat in a way similar to IIT, but at many, many places it is split into portions, and different portions are parceled off to different subjects and different papers. A very common theme seems to be a course in the first year called Basic Mechanical Engineering or Introduction to Mechanical Engineering, which is part of a set of courses called Introduction to X Engineering, where X can be replaced by mechanical, electrical, electronics, civil, what have you. And a typical student goes through about five or six such courses in the first year. So whether he is a student of mechanical, electrical, civil, Introduction to Mechanical Engineering he will go through. And when we looked at the course content or the syllabus or curriculum, we found that the Indian scheme of things seems to be syllabus is split into six units, typically six units. I think that is true in most of the cases. Okay, let us not go into why those six units, but that is the scheme of things. So I said, let me look at, write down the typical units in some 40 or 50 colleges, typically the list from where you have come across, but not exactly. And what I found is there are certain commonalities, but if I take an intersection of all those 40 different syllabi, I find that hardly two units are common. And when I take a union, I find I end up with something like 24 distinct units. Now, similar and slightly different units I have considered dissimilar. So even I found that in the Introduction to Mechanical Engineering, there is no convergence. So it would be very difficult to do that. Then I said that, look, rather than do a hodgepodge of things, you know, because Introduction to Mechanical Engineering would contain not only thermodynamics, some fluid mechanics, something of mechanism, something of power transmission, something about manufacturing, everything under the sun. As it is, mechanical engineering is a very vast field. It is very difficult to say what mechanical engineering is not. Okay, if you look at, most of us are mechanical engineers, so I can say it very loudly. If you look at the engineering syllabus of various branches, I think mechanical engineering syllabus is the most wide. And even from the societal point of view, the abilities expected of a mechanical engineer are among the widest of the abilities expected of any other engineer. So a mechanical engineer will shy away from saying, hey, that's not my job, or I can't do it. He will say, I'll get it done. I will do part of it, other parts I can get it done from my friends. So I said that, look, management people talk of core competence. So what is my core competence? Thermal engineering. Within that, thermodynamics. So let me do justice to thermodynamics itself. And then I found that the way I have listed the scheme of thermodynamics is more or less taught in almost all engineering colleges, but may not be in one single course. Okay. So my first proposal to you is to go through that and assure yourself and tell me if a student in mechanical engineering does not learn these things, these 13 major topics, and of course more, because we don't know where thermal engineering ends and hence where formally thermodynamics ends and something else begins. But in many places, part of this will be in basic mechanical engineering or introduction to mechanical engineering. Part of it will be in course called thermodynamics or applied thermodynamics or energy conversion or something like that. Okay. That is one thing I want a brief discussion on. The second thing I want to conclude by the time we come to lunch is the structure of this particular 5-day interaction. As I said that we are not going to, this is not going to be a just a lecture course in thermodynamics, it is going to be a discussion course. So I would like you to present your ideas to me after the tea break about what is your thinking of the teaching of thermodynamics to undergraduates in mechanical engineering. What is it that you find difficult to make them understand? What are the topics you would like to be discussed threadbare, essentially from a teaching of thermodynamics point of view? If there are certain ideas which are not clear, we will discuss everything from the basics. So if necessary, I won't hesitate in, you know, formally teaching a certain part, but that would be in sort of a lecture demonstration mode. Although it's a lecture, it will be a demonstration of this is the way we teach it. I'm sure there are alternatives. I don't claim to have a unique right to teach thermodynamics in a particular way. In fact, all this structure has been based on my teachers, the others I have seen teaching thermodynamics, good thermodynamics books, and recently good videos on thermodynamics teaching which is available on the net. Okay. Now, just to have the whole thing in line, I distribute a quiz. This is a 2-page paper and there are no marks, but I have roughly said that spend 2 minutes, 1 minute or something like that on each and every question. There are some 10 of them. The last one is matching pairs for which 9 minutes are given. I think the total comes to 26 or 27 minutes. So we should complete this in about 30 minutes. And there is no roll number, but I don't want you to be fully anonymous in the sense I don't want to know who has written which paper. So above the top line, make some mark, some signature, some scribble, so that these papers, I am going to keep a copy, but I would like to return these to you maybe tomorrow or day after. One of the differences between education implementation in an IIT and other places is that IITs is a large postgraduate program, and my postgraduate students are used by me for assisting me as a teacher. They are known as TAs, and two of my TAs have been assigned the job of helping me out. One is Gautam Saha and another one is Chetan Jain. So let's distribute this, and just to tell you that I have come here without any formal material ready with me. Okay. All I have is this thing on which whatever I write, we can see, and we have a absolutely blank electronic paper here on which I will write as things go. So first we have a quiz. I hope you have enjoyed the quiz. I'm not going to evaluate this. This is sort of proof of what I expected. and but I will generally go through. There are some funny things which I have already noticed, and we will discuss that. I am just going to make a copy of this for my own record, and I will return either the original or the copy to you. I think I will return the copy to you. The originals are supposed to be kept with me. So, first thing, any comments on this? On the questions in the test? So, that was the purpose. In fact, this test I tried on, I have tried a few times, and then by the way, Professor Bhandarkar learned thermodynamics from me. He's 22 years younger than me, right? 22 or 23 years younger than me. And the way he has learned thermodynamics from me, I think I should start off by saying that I have learned thermodynamics directly, indirectly from a number of people. Not only from mechanical engineering, but also from physics. At a very basic level, physics textbookish level, perhaps the first exposure to thermodynamics was by one Professor Sundar Rajan, then Professor Viladkar, the late Professor Viladkar, both from the physics department of IIT Bombay. Then from mechanical engineering, Professors Achyutan, later on Professor Jaganmohan, Jagdish, Sukhatme, directly, indirectly, and then Professor D.D. Deshpande of chemistry, who was my co-supervisor for the PhD program. I picked up a lot from him on statistical thermodynamics, kinetic theory, and such stuff. And that is the reason why the title says thermodynamics in mechanical engineering. And one of the situations we find ourselves is that thermodynamics is, although being a basic part of physics and chemistry, is a part of a number of engineering branches too. For example, a student in mechanical engineering will not be considered fully baked mech engineer unless he goes through a study of thermodynamics. But so is true of students in chemical engineering, students in aerospace engineering, students in metallurgy material science. And if you have some odd branches like automobile engineering, thermodynamics is a part of that part too. And in any course, particularly if you are teaching thermodynamics to youngsters, that is first or second year of second year students in mechanical engineering, the question comes up is, what is thermodynamics and what is thermodynamic, what is not thermodynamic, why are we learning it, and what are the predecessors and what are the followers of this type. So after having said that, just I did some content analysis, and I found what I found generally to be true of our first year students in the postgraduate course. This is typically administered to new entrants to our M.Tech program. And although it tells me directly about what they know or what they don't know or the way they have understood thermodynamics, it also indirectly tells me about the way they have been taught thermodynamics. Okay. That was an indirect assessment of the way thermodynamics was taught to them. This is because you are teachers of thermodynamics, this is more or less a direct assessment. Okay. And what I found is, not only for those students who come with a BE or BTech from outside the IIT system, but also for our own students at the undergraduate level, and which must be true for your students, is that when you start teaching them thermodynamics, they already have some idea of, some vague idea of thermodynamics from a portion called heat in their high school, and some patchwork study of thermodynamics during their 12th standard, that is HSS, sometimes in physics, sometimes in chemistry, sometimes in both. And I find that I have to make them realize that although they know how to solve some simple problems in thermodynamics, their understanding of the principles of thermodynamics is very, very weak. In fact, the way our education scheme has been implementing the 11th, 12th teaching, it's essentially, you know, as Professor Fatak said, pass the exam, get good marks. That means solve the problems or answer the questions. You know, understanding the basic subject, whatever it be, it's secondary. Okay. Even today's Times of India, there are articles about this. I think that's because I think from today, in many states, the higher secondary exam is beginning today or this week. And I find that many of us also have the same confusion about thermodynamics. So before I start telling you something, I would like a few of you to say something about what is expected of this interaction and what is the problem, if at all, you face in teaching thermodynamics, or which is not the same thing as teaching thermodynamics, making your students learn thermodynamics. It's open. I would like some hot discussion, because as I said, that this is not going to be a one-way street. Oh, good. 2-3 hands were there up already.
Sir, I would like to say that there are few topics which are very difficult to understand. Rather, it may be from my side or from the student side. So I would like to have some discussions on that topic. For example, entropy, available energy, and of course, the PVT surfaces, that is of steam. That I would like to discuss.
Okay. Thanks. That you find is a general difficulty. No, I'll give you enough time. There is no time restriction. And more, sir, the discussion, better.
Sir, discussion on the thermodynamic relations, like Maxwell equations.
Maxwell equations.
Actually, when I am teaching the Maxwell equation, just I mug up and deliver it. Okay. Actually, I could not understand what I have to, comparing to other units, I cannot strong in that particular way.
Okay.
But I can understand how it is derived and how it is to be.
You can derive it.
Yeah, derive it.
No difficulty, but understanding.
Yeah, the understanding is the matter.
Okay.
The same thing is for Clausius inequality also, sir.
Okay. Okay. So the things related to second law seem to be one gray area, one difficult area. Okay.
Availability.
Okay.
We are not able to correlate with the practical examples.
Okay, let me just note down here. We started off by saying generally second law. Entropy.
Availability. How to relate it with the practical examples?
Availability. Then Clausius inequality. Then property relations, particularly Maxwell's relations. Not really the derivation, but the understanding of the physics behind it. Okay. PVT surfaces. You wanted to say something?
Actually, I would like to learn the basic concepts and their applications, how to give the number of application about this thermodynamic topics. Not related, because even though first law or a Carnot cycle, we are explaining it, there is a adiabatic system and everything, but students asking number of questions. How are they?
Same thing, sir. Adiabatic process, reverse, we say reversible isentropic process. But how actually the question has been asked in the quiz, whether isobaric process is a the reversible isentropic or not. Adiabatic. So actually
what a question on that?
That adiabatic is isobaric, can
a process be both adiabatic and
isobaric? So what actually happening inside the turbine or the actually adiabatic process not possible in actual case. So we are why we are considering a theoretical when we are theoretically examining. So on that I want to interact.
Sir, evolving Helmholtz and Gibbs function.
Okay, that comes to property relations.
Hello,
Maxwell's
sir.
Maxwell's relations come from there.
Yeah.
Yes, Brahmara.
Actually, I taught thermodynamics only once when I newly joined in this profession. So later I taught.
But your background is mech or chemical?
Mechanical, sir. Okay. Mechanical engineering.
Because you know the way they look at thermodynamics is different.
Yes, I understand, sir. Later part of my teaching, I was only I was given most of the applied part of it, like thermal engineering, heat transfer, refrigeration, air conditioning, and things like that. So when I went to some courses in IIT Chennai and places like that for initial workshops, I found that I have totally my way of understanding the things and the way of teaching the things have totally I learnt in a different way. I have understood the conceptual way, a logical way of teaching the things. So I came here basically to know to see how a subject which I feel a very fundamental subject for mechanical engineering is taught so that I can disseminate the same knowledge for the faculty in and around the colleges. So I came here for that, sir.
Any further? Mandar?
I would like to add the same thing that any of topic of your interest, let us say just for 10 to 15 minutes, you can give us the example how exactly to teach that thing. It may be the simple one or the complicated
one. That will happen. That will happen because the way the whole thing is the way it is going, I can't do justice to it unless I sort of lecture them almost the whole of.
It will be the best example for us also.
Okay.
Thank you.
If you can the intricacies of the molecular disorder that we always teach to our
students
that is the entropy of the molecular disorder.
But now, if I say that except in a passing way, I am not going to talk about any molecular disorder and we will derive entropy in a very properly engineering way, I think you should be happy, right? Now let me ask you any more comments. Let me make a comment, but comments from you on my or even otherwise are welcome, because we have another about how much 25 minutes for the tea break. As I said that just take out the sequence of topics. Do you generally agree that the sequence of topics is in order, more or less? So that's one thing. Now I'll tell you something. In IIT Bombay also, for some reason, I think historically, IIT Bombay have had in mechanical engineering, in chemical engineering, and in physics, also in chemistry, very good professors interested in thermodynamics. They may not be involved in basic research in thermodynamics because the thermodynamics research ends up being of the applied kind, except for development of theories of thermodynamics, which all the great minds have more or less done. There is nothing much left to do in basic thermodynamics, but I think there is a great thing left to do in deciding how to teach basic thermodynamics, and I think that's what we are here for. And because of that, the course in mechanical engineering thermodynamics has evolved over the years as a really good course. I have seen the development, the way it was taught to me as an undergraduate, and the way it changed when I was doing my PhD here, and the way it developed as I and my colleagues started teaching. I think it has now, I shouldn't say fully baked, but it has become reasonably well baked. But even then, let me tell you something. out of the 13 topics listed here, 13 major topics listed here, the first 11 topics have always been part of our thermodynamics course. Over the years, some have become more, the emphasis has changed slightly. It also changes the way the teacher is. The teacher changes, some topics will be de-emphasized, some more topics will be emphasized. It also depends on the speed of the teacher. Here we have a course syllabus which is in about 100 and 150 words. And after that, it's like one of those Indian classical music schemes. You have a raga which has a few themes which define the raga, then the singer is left to himself. And even the same singer, a good singer, when he recites that raga for, in 10 different performances, you will have 10 different implementations. But you agree that it's the same Miyake Mallar or whatever it is. So that way it changes. So I can say that more or less topics 1 to 12 are the proper contents of any undergraduate first course in mechanical engineering thermodynamics. Depending on our design of the subsequent courses and the speed of the teacher, sometimes introduction to cycles is included. Sometimes introduction to psychrometry is included, sometimes introduction to compressible fluid flow is included, because here we have a sequence of courses in mechanical engineering. They typically go as thermodynamics, fluid mechanics, heat transfer and applied thermodynamics or introduction to energy conversion. And if a teacher finds that the student crowd is good, he can go a bit fast. Even include some topic from fluid mechanics like compressible fluid flow, which is more or less an extension of our open system formulation. Okay. In fact, inviscid compressible flow of an ideal gas or even using steam can be taught very properly in a course in thermodynamics. That is why that much encroachment is done in fluid mechanics. Sometimes introduction to combustion. Stoichiometry is also included in the first course in thermodynamics. Okay, so apart from such divergence, I think this 13 topics as we agree is good enough. Now I want to know, there are some 35 teachers here, how many colleges or how many syllabi have this in one single course? Oh, reasonable number, good. Oh, quite a good number. And how many places are there where this happens to be partitioned into, say, two courses like introduction to mech engineering, some part and some other part? Oh, not as many as earlier. I am happy that thermodynamics is slowly gaining its proper thing. Now, where there is a full course in thermodynamics, isn't there an introduction to mechanical engineering course? There is no, quite a few places there is no introduction to mechanical engineering. At a few places there will be intro to mechanical engineering, but that may not have much of thermodynamics in it. Okay, that's good for us, because I think, and I get a feeling that if there is a majority, if, you know, 6 years ago, so many hands would not have gone up, because this full course in thermodynamics at that time I know did not exist in many places. It was always split into intro to mech engineering and something called thermodynamics or applied thermodynamics. Okay. Now, what about textbooks? Which are the common textbooks which are used? NAG, Senjel Bowles, okay. Van Weylen, Sontag, Van Weylen, Borgnak, the authors keep on changing in combination. Okay, CPRO RIS, Balani, old one, and how much, 40th edition? But that's a huge one. But one thing you will agree that, which I also find that there is no book which caters exactly to this. It's always more than this. But I find that in spite of going through those books, because those books are written, they are excellent books, no doubt. All of you have said, I have not seen Balani. I have seen Pielder, I have seen Sontag, I have seen Sontag Van Weylen, all those. I have seen Nag, all editions. I have seen Senjel Bowles and a few others. Most of them in one way or the other are very good books for students, okay. But they are not really good books for teachers. Second thing is, I think over the years, those books have become big, verbose, okay, and the style has changed in such a way that I think they expect the student to read through the book and understand everything on his or her own. I think that is the way perhaps the style has been changing. If you look at the books of 1960s and 70s when I was a student, it was very clear that the book is written to be used along with some professors teaching in class. Okay. At that time, quite clearly it was written, the derivation of this is left as an exercise to the student. Nowadays you hardly find that in many books. Okay. In fact, I have not seen a book in thermodynamics, but I have seen a book in heat transfer, big thick one, in which one dimensional steady state conduction occupied something like 60 pages. The whole derivation, plane parallel slab, both temperatures specified, plane parallel slab, left side temperature specified, right side heat transfer coefficient, then right side temperature specified, left side heat transfer coefficient. All these cases are derived. Okay. So, even a Dumbo will get bold, if I can say so. Have you looked at, now the books which you mentioned are essentially written for engineers, by engineers, mainly mechanical engineers. Have you ever looked at or used books which were written for physicists or by physicists? Yes, but the Resnik-Halliday is at a very, very basic level. In fact, my first exposure to thermodynamics by Professor Sundar Rajan were those 4 or 5 chapters of thermodynamics in Resnik-Halliday. Yeah, YVC Rao, that is, but the tone is entirely different because it is mainly for chemical engineers. To some extent, it is good perhaps for chemists also. And the book by Professor Dhar of IIT Delhi. See, any good textbook, not only of thermodynamics, but of any other subject, should not necessarily or should not restrict itself to what the student is expected to learn through that course. The boundaries of the book should be wider than the boundaries of the course material which is expected of the student. Okay, because the subject is very vast, and if you start covering everything of the subject, then the library may not be sufficient. But there are many books which fall into a trap of the following. A good author writes a good book, first edition, but it's a quick and dirty work. The people realize that's good, so good feedback comes, and the second and third edition perhaps is a very, very mature, nice thing. But then the comments come saying, in my university, this topic is included, but that's not there in the book. Okay. Then some other person says something else should also be included. Now this is important, that should also be included. And then you end up with adding those topics and the book becomes bulkier and bulkier. And that you will find not only of engineering books, but that you will find of even physics books. For example, a few of you may know, there are very good authors of physics which are friends of engineers. For example, Szymanski's book on heat and thermodynamics, it's a classic. And now I don't know whether Professor Szymanski is there or not, but it is Szymanski and someone else. And the third to fifth editions of Szymanski's heat and thermodynamics are perhaps the excellent ones. But from sixth edition, so much material started getting included that a good student and even a good professor seems lost in it. Along with Szymanski, there was a co-author, Sears. Sears and Szymanski wrote college physics books together. Sears himself has written a book on thermodynamics, kinetic theory, and statistical mechanics. That was my textbook for the physics thermodynamics. And I like that book because, without being partial to macroscopic or microscopic theories, he gave a more or less balanced thing, not more than maybe 250 pages. But of course, it was a book for a serious student. There were lots of things, not loose ends, but open channels left for the student to discover. I think Sears has retired, is no more. Now, Sears and Salinger have come up with new editions of that book, and that still remains a good book, mainly from the physics point of view. What I have found is, if you go through the second handout, that is exercises, the exercises had some 19 pages of exercises in 8 groupings. I think the total number is 111, followed by some charts, and you have also been given this team table. First thing is, on the first page, behind the title, you will find text and references. There are a list of 5 books, and I have specifically not included Nag and Senjel and Bowles, because everybody knows about them. Okay, so instead of just making it longer, I have put books which I think you should refer to. I think Sontag has already been mentioned. But Szymanski, I am restricting myself to the 4th edition, notice 1957. Similarly, Sears and Salinger, I don't think after 75 there is an edition, there are only new prints. Maybe that is why it has remained good. Achyutan was one of my professors here. I think it is appropriate for me to put him at the top, but anyway, that is not the reason, it is an alphabetical list, that is why Achyutan happens to be number 1. Moran and Shapiro is another good book. I think a 5th edition has come out after 2000, but I think slowly it is also going the way Senjel and Bowles has gone. Initially it was compact and nice, and now it has become bulkier and bulkier. Now it becomes so bulkier that a few years later it will be good exercise just to lift it up and put it down on the table. Out of which, Sears, Salinger and Szymanski are essentially physics oriented. Sontag, Van Weylen, Moran Shapiro and Achyutan, they are essentially engineering with different type of styles. And one of my recommendation is, once you go back to your institutes, colleges, see to it that you have at least one copy of these in your library. These are good for, particularly for a teacher to refer to. Now, the charts I have obtained from the internet, there is nothing special about them. And also there is nothing special about these steam tables. I have given you a copy just to see to it that when we come to the discussion of steam tables, we are on a common ground. Otherwise, what happens? The style, perhaps the units, the number of significant figures, the way things are tabulated, the spacing are all different in different tables. Although the principle remains the same, it is good to have a common basis. So, listing this here doesn't mean that this is a strongly recommended steam table, but it's a good steam table, and we have been using it for how much? 20 years or something like that. The only a few weeks ago, the 10th edition, or no, I don't know the edition number, 2010 edition has come up, and we have found that that's good enough for our purpose. So now, after the, it's almost tea time, maybe, oh, inadvertently I have started with 1.1, textbooks and other materials, right? So is it okay to start our discussion more or less in this order? Okay, but I want continuous feedback as to please emphasize this, please illustrate this in more detail, or why not a divergence and things like that. So we will, because we have agreed to this, we will generally go in this scheme. Okay? And this is more or less the scheme of thing which is followed by us in our thermodynamics teaching. So I have kept it, but the context here will be different. We have already discussed textbooks. The next topic here is evaluation scheme. Usually this is the time when I tell the students that we are going to have so many quizzes of this type, and what's the penalty if you misbehave during the quizzes, etc. But see, in IITs, and particularly in IIT Bombay, we have a, I shouldn't say reasonable, we have very, very flexible when it comes to evaluation scheme. You can get away with, well, almost murder, so long as you have something called an end semester exam with some weightage to it, and which is held according to the centralized timetable. What you do during the semester is essentially left to the instructor or the teacher. I am sure a few, only a few of you will have this flexibility. What is the type of evaluation scheme that you have? I think all of us now are in the semester system. Okay. I think nobody is remaining in the annual system anymore. And that means you have some in-semester evaluation and some end-semester evaluation. How much is the weightage for the end-semester evaluation? 50, 60, 80. Any place where it is 100? Which in?
So out of 150 marks, 100 marks are absolutely that one single exam. So I can say about 67% roughly. Okay. Some people said 50%. Where is that? But which? This is PhD tech. No, that's okay. I'm mainly interested in the end semester examination. 50%. I mean, 50%. Okay, you also have.
Anna University also. 75.
But no, generally what I see is 50 to 80 seems to be the range. Okay, one way or the other. But there is no 100% weightage for. Is there any? I mean, some weightage is there for what you do during the semester. Okay. Now,
And I think that is true for each and every subject that they learn throughout their this thing, whether it is mechanical engineering, whether it is economics, whether it is unless something which is purely laboratory work, which will be different. So fluid mechanics will be treated in a similar way, strength of materials will also be treated in a similar way. I'm a paper can be 1 million mark, doesn't matter. Okay, that's a matter of local detail.
We have in Anna University, we have 50-50. All the engineering colleges in the state of Tamil Nadu are affiliated to Anna University of Technology, where we have a weightage of 80%.
Oh, so in the university itself it is 50-50, but affiliated colleges it is 20-80 type. That means within the university there is a difference. No, direct colleges and affiliated colleges.
Anna University, where we had all the engineering colleges affiliated. Now a separate university has been formed in the name of Anna University of Technology, depending on the location, like Kochi, Coimbatore, and so on and so forth. So in for the self-financing engineering colleges, we have 80-20. Anna University is an autonomous institution.
So you have 50-50.
It's a university college.
Yeah. So, but the papers also will be different. The syllabus may also be slightly different. Okay. Understand. Now, what I feel is that, and I have done experiments over this, and I have more or less come to a conclusion that at least for the type of students we get here, the standard IIT scheme I modify. The standard IIT scheme today for any course, if you don't say anything, this is what everybody will be doing. Typically 3-hour paper, 50%. That is after 14 weeks of teaching. After 7 weeks of teaching, we have, currently it is going on this week, that's why I have scheduled it this week from my convenience. We have the mid-semester examination, a 2-hour paper, 30% weightage. Okay. Now that means 20% weightage remains. That 20% weightage is distributed by the teacher any way he or she feels like. Any combination of quizzes, assignments, vivas, some minor weightage for attendance could also be there. Okay. Some small, maybe 5%, 10%, no more than that. Usually by default, many teachers tend to do after about 4 weeks of teaching a test of 1 hour, 10% weightage. Then after 7 weeks of teaching, mid-semester, 30%, another 3-4 weeks of teaching, a test of about 1 hour, 10%, and then finally 50% end sem. My experience shows that in thermodynamics, there are so many small items which one has to learn, and unless that learning is complete, or unless those concepts are absorbed, or unless I force the student to absorb those, their learning and absorption of the following concepts becomes difficult. And hence, left to me, I would conduct a quiz. And the quiz is essentially of the type which I gave you, the format, okay, it's not the content. Typically one sheet, single sheet, write your, there will be space for roll number and name, a question here, and everything else is blank. Yes, but now the difference I will tell you, typically 15 or 20 minutes, once every 2 weeks, no mid-semester. So I end up with about 6 or 7 quizzes in a semester, and I give a weightage of 60%. The end semester is a 3-hour examination, 3 hours because they sit parallelly with other students. I don't mind having it even a 2-hour examination, but then the others will get distracted. Yeah, at the end of 2 hours, all thermo students will be very happy that their exam is over, and they will make lots of noise, and students and teachers of other courses will be complaining. So a 3-hour paper, no more than 40% weightage. And I have found that not only is it good for the teacher, because the students are alert, they know that a few hours later there is going to be an examination. The exercises, what I have given you is a almost complete set, maybe some 10 or 12 exercises which are more or less repeat or essentially for the student warm up, that I have not included. But those 111 problems, I suppose they are so, is essentially the heart of our undergraduate thermodynamics tutorial sheet. Okay. They may be rearranged in different form the way the teacher presents. So you can say that about one tutorial sheet out there comes to more or less one quiz, sometimes more, sometimes less, but roughly of that order. And because of that, a student is forced to learn something almost every week. I understand that in a university system and in an affiliated system, this is not possible. But it is possible that a few of you will be in colleges which are autonomous, or few of you will be in colleges which are thinking of becoming autonomous, or you will end up in one such college. And autonomy doesn't only mean that you are free of the day-to-day interference and day-to-day governing by the university. You are free to take your own decisions. And that not only means the top management of the college, but also the heads of departments and also the faculty becoming autonomous more or less for their course. And when that comes, I don't want a discussion now. Start thinking, for whatever course you are teaching, what is the best way to evaluate students? Because remember, our job is to teach, but the end product is that the student should learn. And we should do everything which would make the student learn in a friendly and comfortable way. And I find that a quiz every alternate week, during the class hour or tutorial hour, 15-20 minutes, and a short problem, no extra paper, this is the question, this is the space that you have, that works best. Okay, this is what I wanted to tell you about the evaluation scheme. I agree that immediately it not be possible for you, many of you, but if at all it is possible, think over. I have told you what my scheme is, but based on your experience, you come up with your own scheme. Now the next one, mechanical engineering, thermal engineering and thermodynamics. One of the problems that we all face is that students come to engineering, and students in IIT are no exception. Many of them come to engineering and take up a particular branch of engineering because of what we call the mob mentality. You are a good student, you should take up science in 11 and 12. Oh, you have done well in science, you must appear for your CET or JEE or whatever those dozen examinations are conducted. Oh, you got a good rank in CET, you must take computer science. Okay. And you must go to this college. Oh, you didn't get computer science, what is the next best? That depends on you, maybe mechanical, maybe electronics, maybe what have you. Okay. The liking of the student and the inherent goodness of the student in engineering in general and mechanical engineering in particular is not really looked at. Consequently, a teacher has to make some effort in keeping the student's interest live in engineering in general and mechanical engineering in particular. And because a decision has been taken by many students almost by default that they will sign up for a BE or BTEC in mechanical engineering, you ask them what mechanical engineering is about. We don't know. It's something to do with cars, something to do with something. I'll tell you a personal story. When I signed up for engineering, my old grandmother, father's mother, she called me up and say, "Hey, I heard you are going to become an engineer." I said, "Yes." Then she asked me, "What type of engineer?" This all happened in local vernacular Marathi Konkani combination, but I'll tell you it in English. Then immediately my problem was, how do I explain to her what mechanical engineering is? So, but perhaps she noted my hesitation and she said, I know three types of engineers. Tell me which one you are going to be. She said, one is the engineer who builds houses and such stuff. Another is an engineer who, you know, lays out all these wires for lights, fans and such things. Third is an engineer who looks after cars, locomotives and such machines. You know, I was surprised at that time that that old lady may not have learned more than a few standards. I don't think she ever went anywhere near SSC. Okay. But she had a perfect grasp of what the three basic then branches of engineering meant, civil, electrical, mechanical. Okay, so I explained to her that, well, I am going to look after the engineering which takes care of cars, steam engines, trains and all that. And I was in mechanical engineering, but what I did not realize that as I grew in mechanical engineering, my interest in thermal engineering and in thermodynamics would grow. But you know, even you ask a student what mechanical engineering is about, what is engineering about, what do we do it for, they are not sure what they are. And hence it becomes very difficult for them to understand what is the place of thermodynamics in mechanical engineering and why should we learn thermodynamics. And this confusion exists because they have been exposed to something called heat or thermodynamics in school, typically in physics courses. They have done some simple calorimetric experiment. They know that you know, heat lost by the calorimeter is heat gained by water or the other way around. And you have water and then there is a blob of copper in it, a hot blob or a hot water in which you put the cold copper and measure the change in temperature. All of us have done this experiment in school. Then we have something called a water equivalent for the calorimeter. So all these confusing terms are there. Then they come to 11-12 standard. I think in 11-12 in many places, physics doesn't have much of thermodynamics, but chemistry has enough thermodynamics. So they end up with a gas means PV must be RT. They end up with an adiabatic process means PV raised to gamma is constant. You ask a student, what is heat? Oh, heat is MC delta T, because that is the formula which is needed for, you know, getting those 2 marks or 2.5 marks in CET. And with such, you know, vague ideas, may not be totally incorrect, but incompletely assimilated ideas, they come to us. And then they suddenly are confronted by the fact that, oh, I am in mechanical engineering, there is a big subject called thermodynamics, 100 mark paper. I mean, what's so great about thermodynamics in it? Why am I learning it? And then he finds that his colleague in chemical engineering was also doing thermodynamics, but his textbook is different, the way his teacher talks about is different, the way he sketches diagrams is different, he is using some triangular graph papers which we have never seen. Then there is a student in metallurgy material science whose thermodynamics is neither like mechanical engineering, neither like chemical engineering. Some things are common, but they are entirely different. In metallurgy material science, they never talk about something which is flowing. They don't worry about open thermodynamic systems. Okay. And in chemical engineering, they always talk of either a closed reactor, a continuously stirred tank reactor, or an open process. They talk of batch process and continuous process. Okay, so this leads to confusion.